And welcome to our service here at Grace United Methodist Church. This is the 18th of July. And welcome also to those watching on YouTube or Facebook. Start with our call to worship.
God, we are aliens and sojourners in this world, but you invite us to be your guests.
You lavishly offer us your hospitality and lovingly welcome us into your family. You invite us to share in the abundance of your kingdom.
Remind us that when we offer hospitality to others, we are receiving Christ into our midst and so fulfilling the law of love.
God, you have shown us that providing hospitality to strangers opens a doorway into the kingdom of God. We open our hearts to embrace the stranger, the friend, the rich, and the poor.
We open our lives to offer a generous heart to all.
Please join me in prayer. You are the Alpha and Omega, O Lord. You are the creator of all, and we glorify your name. We invite you into our presence today. We cannot do anything except your blessings. May we be filled with your spirit and your holy power. May you accept our worship as we sing your praises. Let everything that we do today and every day be divinely guided by your power. May the manifestations of your will be present always in our lives. Open the door to heaven and bring us your abundant blessings. May your joy overflow within us today and for every day of our lives. Amen. Please join in our opening hymn, 545, The Church is One Foundation, verses 1 through 4. Please stand.
Thank you.
Can you please turn and greet one another? You can be seated. Announcements this morning. Please always check your bulletin. We got our birthday listings and events this week. There's council meeting tomorrow night at 6:30. And please feel free to come even if you don't have a position that requires you to be there. So always welcome more participation. Tuesday evening at 5:30 is prayer meeting, then followed by Bible study. And Saturday morning is men's Bible study. Just the announcement there about watching, of course, on Facebook and YouTube. I'm asking Ted to come up and give us a report on Bible school.
Thank you, Debbie. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Yes, we had a good successful Bible school, and we had 18, 20, 20, and 23 each day, four days. And it's just, we decided to go instead of four groups into two groups, because one group didn't have hardly, well, they had two show up, so we went to two groups, and it turned out well. There was eight to 10, or 11 or 12 in each group each day between the two groups. And that gave us a lot more time to teach the lesson, do crafts, take more time eating snacks, do the story. The story is very important. Pastor Ruby did the story. So thank you everyone that helped out. You know who you are. It amazes me when we see the body of Christ work. It works well. It works together. And it just amazes me. And I see it happening these several years that I've been designated the director of Vacation Bible School. I get a little anxious when that time arrives, but guys just start asking the Lord to calm me down and make phone calls, and people respond. And we handed out pretty green, like lemon-colored t-shirts with the logo Shipwreck Rescued by Jesus. And we sent them home with these little books, notes from Jesus, what your new best friend wants you to know. And we're able to order them and get them here on time. So that's it. We took an offering. And we've been doing this every year, giving to the HACAP. That's an acronym for, I'm not sure exactly what all those stand, whether it's an after school church or a children's lunch program for families that might not have make ends meet to have enough put three meals together, or they come up short. And this program supplies lunches for these children. Then we collected $123, and we got a new pig in the house right here. If you look down here, right here, this is something that Peggy or Debbie Bryant come up with years ago that she just had to get it. And this is what you put your coins in right here. And it goes down the pig's belly, down his, his tubes there, and it goes right there in his belly. And there was $22.64 in that thing. And so we'll have this setting, so you can bring your coins and your quarters. You can put in the Heifer Project and the other coins. We'll have this setting out next to that, up there in the lobby, and you can put your coins in that, and That's what we'll do. So.
Amen.
Okay, we're going to watch some video about what happened at Vacation Bible School.
Well, thank you, Ted, for being our leader. You generously offer leadership when we most need it. But there's some other people to thank, too.
Yeah.
Carice, we thank him for all his gift of helping with the photography work. And we kind of saw him here and there, but we never saw him in the video because he was behind the camera. So thank you so much for that. We also want to give a big thanks to the Swinka family. Not only did Dad and Susie give their gift of leadership and their teaching abilities, but we also thank their family for their generous financial support that was from Mary's memorial. And Mary was a true child of God, and she was at home with the children. We certainly missed her, but still felt her presence. And so we just want to remember that she was always a big part of that. Did I miss any, I didn't give any people a chance to add any other announcements I might have missed? Is there anything? Okay. All right. Then we'll move forward with our offering. I'll also ask if you have any prayer requests, please use the slips and put those in the offering plate. And our, I'll ask, we have ushers this morning. I don't know if we had anyone designated. Robin and Judy, would you volunteer to be our ushers?
Praise Him, all creatures, here below.
before we go with our pastoral prayer, I would like to welcome in our midst the family of Ameo and Celine. Ameo and Celine. Celine, Ameo is at the back and Celine is here. And Christiana, Hannah, and the sleeping one. What's the name of the sleeping baby?
Brianna.
She was tired already. Well, we were at the closing time of the Vacation Bible School, and I got her sleeping. Welcome, and we are happy that you're joining our church. Amen. Yeah, and also we are happy for Lauren. Lauren, I think, is going to school, going away for school. What school are you attending, Lauren?
It's not school, it's like First National Service.
Okay, so she'll be gone for, I understand, 10 months, right, Lauren? And so this is her last Sunday here in church, and after 10 months, she'll be back, right, Lauren? And then she'll continue in our prayers as you go for our service, and so may God's protection be upon you. And I remember last year I prayed for a special lady, and she said, Pastor, could you please include me? I'll be going away to a mission, and I'll be back. And so we prayed for her, and praise God, now she's back. Let's welcome in our Miss Dina. God is so good. And so let us bow down our heads in prayer. Lord God, Jesus, our Redeemer, we come to your throne of grace acknowledging that you are our Heavenly Father, our Provider, our Maker, our Protector. And through your goodness, we are alive and healthy enough to gather in this place and worship you. We praise you for all that you have given us. And so we commit all our good deeds to you and ask that everything that we do be done for your glory. We ask that everything that we have done, O God, may it be for your glory alone. Father, we are thankful that we can surrender our lives to you in our worship today. As a congregation gathered today, we lift up and remember all those who could not be with us today. Lord, you know our prayer list. You know our prayer concerns. You know those people whose names are written in our prayer concerns in our bulletin. You know them, O God. And so we lift all of them today to you. For those who are sick, we pray for their healing so that they may gather again to praise you with us here in church. Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit to move among us and all those who are not with us, worshiping with us, those who are in pain, those who are struggling. Lord, comfort us, support us, as we work to honor you in our own special way. Inspire us to learn more about your majestic ways and the beauty of your grace. Allow us to have a deeper relationship with you as we turn all our worries, our struggles, and our pain to you. We thank you for the family of Ameo and Celine who's joining us in this church. Thank you, Lord God, and we continue to lift up their family unto you. Bless them, O God. And even Lauren Laswell. Lord, she is looking forward to a 10-month service, wherever she is going, O God. Lord, let your protection follow her. And may your presence continue to guide her wherever she is going and all those challenges that she will encounter. Lord God, we even thank you for your protection, the troubling mercies that you have given to Dina, your faithfulness to her and to her family in sustaining her, sustaining the whole family even if they have been away for many months. Lord, thank you for bringing back Dina, and we continue to declare blessings unto their family, the family of Brian and Dina. O Heavenly Father, you know what is the need of each and every one of us right now. And so we lift all of them unto you. when God reach out to us and touch us, embrace us, and grant what we desire in our heart. For we hail you as our Lord. Lord God, we continue with our worship with you today, and it is our prayer that may our praises, Lord God, may our songs, may our words, may the things that we do, may the thoughts that we think, Lord God, be pleasing to your sight. We ask all of this in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please rise if you're able for the reading of our scripture? Ephesians 2. Therefore remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me now in the response singing. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
I
A blessed Sunday once again, brothers and sisters in the Lord. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
The church has been so blessed with the presence of crew members and castaways in our vacation Bible school that is entitled Shipwreck this week. For 4 days, we have been shipwrecked, right? Crew members, and we were glad we were able to finish the four-day Bible school. Well, we could have survived if there was a fifth day, right? Maybe Ted, right? Amen, Ted?
Amen.
I have observed that Ted had made the church his home this week. He was always here doing something morning, noon, and evening. Praise God for the big help from all the crews of our Vacation Bible School. Can I request all those who have helped the Vacation Bible School to please stand up? Can we give them a clap of applause? And may I ask you to raise your hand? Like this? No, not you. Those who are sitting in the pews. Can I request you to please raise your hand towards someone is standing? Okay. And let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you so much for the life of these believers who have committed to helping in our vacation Bible school this week. We know that it's not hard to teach young kids. But then we thank you for the strength that you have given them. And it is our prayer and declaration that you will continue to strengthen, you will continue to bless the children's ministry of our church. Lord, and this week, Lord, you did it again through these crew members that have helped in making this Vacation Bible School possible. We know that we couldn't have done anything without you. That is why as we continue to declare your blessings to these crew members that have helped, we bring back all the praises and the glory to your name. For this is our prayer in your name. Amen. Thank you for all the time and the support that you have given to the children's ministry of our church. So today, brothers and sisters in the Lord, allow me to share my insights on the Vacation Bible School. Ted gave the Bible story part to me. That was my assignment, and so I would want to share them to the congregation, to you, today. The title of the Vacation Bible School is Shipwreck, and if you read shipwreck, it would mean that you're shipwrecked. Those who are joining the Vacation Church School are shipwrecked. They are lost. And I would say, isn't that true in our life as believers in the Lord? And even if when we haven't met the Lord, we have been shipwrecked. Can I ask you, have you been shipwrecked in your life?
Absolutely.
I would say, I have been shipwrecked a lot of times. But then, this theme, shipwreck, below it, there's a caption. Can you read that one?
Rescued by Jesus.
Oh, you have sharp eyes. We are shipwrecked, but then we are rescued by Jesus. Jesus comes to our rescue. So the first topic, the first day, when we feel lost and lonely, Jesus rescues. We become lost sometime, like the lost sheep on the 100 sheep that the shepherd was tending, one got lost. Or like the prodigal son. We all know the story of the parable of the prodigal son, that the prodigal son was lost. And when he had nothing except himself and his clothes, well, he realized that he was lost. And he decided to go back to his father. God, like the shepherd, will look for us if we are lost. God, like the father in the parable of the lost son, will accept us when we realize our sin and come back to him. Now, the question is there someone here who feels lonely and lost? Do you feel lonely? Do you feel lost? Psalm 27 verse 10 says, "The Lord will hold me close." So if there is someone who is feeling lost or is feeling lonely right now, let this verse speak to you. The Lord will hold me close. Say it, the Lord will hold me close. I believe these verses are for those who feel lonely and lost. So if you are, claim this promise as you say it. Let the Lord hold you close, my brother. Let the Lord hold you close, my sister. Call on Him. Call on Him. And Jesus will come to your rescue. Trust Him. That's number one. The second, when we feel worried, Jesus rescues. Well, they have an animal body, and this is Beacon. The other one is a tiger, and that was Hope. But I haven't listened to the explanation. I'm just focusing on the Bible point and the Bible verse. So the second one is, when we feel worried, Jesus rescues. Sometimes we are like Martha. Martha, who was worried of not serving Jesus right when he came to visit her home. And Mary was sitting beside Jesus, not doing anything to help. And Martha got worried. Martha, when she allowed all her job to overwhelm her and forgot that being with Jesus was the best thing that she could have done, began to complain. She complained, "Jesus, why is Mary sitting there and I am doing here busy and you're not even telling my sister, my beloved, beautiful sister, to come and help me?" And what was the answer of Jesus? "Martha, Martha, your sister has chosen the best thing, the one thing. That's what you should choose too." Now, these are worries. Martha was really, there's nothing wrong in being busy and being servant and being hospitable. There's nothing wrong with that. But when our being busy, our being hospitable makes us complain and removes that joy in our heart of serving, that's a different thing. Worries must be replaced with trust to the one who makes all things well. Because it is not us who makes all things well. Even if we plan 100% perfect, it will be imperfect. It will be what God wants. Now, worries must be replaced with that one thing, the best thing, and that is Jesus. Worries must be replaced with more prayer. Worries must be replaced with spending more time with Jesus. Worries must be given to the one who counts the winds and the waves. And there's a song, I think this is the second song, the second time that I have sang this song. Give them all, are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows? Are you tired of spinning round and round? Cast up all your worries to Jesus, at the feet of Jesus, lay them down. Give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams, wounded hearts, broken toils. Give them all, give them all to Jesus. And He will turn your worries into joy. I replace the sorrows with worry. Just give them to Jesus and He will replace it with joy. Is there anyone who is worried about something today? Psalm 34 verse 19 says, "The Lord comes to the rescue each time." The psalmist said this. Psalm 34 verse 19, "The Lord comes to the rescue each time." So, let's give our worries. Take it, Jesus. I have my worries here, I give it to you. Do whatever you want to do with it. That's the second day. We're still on the third day, we're still halfway, okay? Alright, so the third point, when we struggle, Jesus rescues. I believe it would be well for us to be reminded that Jesus struggled too. You know what, before this Bible, I have learned something. Because in the prayer of Gethsemane, the focus when I read the text is that Jesus prayed. Jesus prayed. And he asked God to take away the cup. That was it. But it's not focused on the struggle that Jesus had gone through. Jesus, while he was praying there, was he struggling? Lord, please, should I do this or not? I don't want to do this. Could you please take it away? I know that it will be hard. But I know I have to. But then I don't like it. Huh, I like it. I am willing to obey. But I am afraid. I know that it will be hard for me. That's a struggle, right? The struggling is, you know, that you will undergo through a difficulty in life. Now, when Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, well, when Susie was asking the kids, what was the story? And what was the garden? He was asking the kids the garden, and then they could not answer. And then the kids would say, Garden of Olive? I said, no, it's not the Olive Garden. It's the Garden of Gethsemane. Okay, we're going back. And that's just a blooper. Okay. That Olive Garden is Garden of Gethsemane. Now, Jesus struggled in that garden, and God did not answer his requests with a yes. It's no. You have to continue with your mission. You have to die on the cross. And Jesus struggled. And even if he struggled, Jesus obeyed God. He knew that he would suffer, and he knew that God would be with him in his struggle. So, brothers and sisters in the Lord, when we struggle, it doesn't mean that God will spare us from the pain of our struggle. What God promised is that he will be with us as we struggle. God did not leave Jesus alone. He was with Jesus when he struggled going into the cross of Calvary. God, for us, God does not remove our struggle. But what God has promised, he will be with us in our struggle. So, is there anyone who is struggling today? I will not ask you to raise your hand. You know your struggle. I know my struggle. Even little kids, they have struggle, and I ask them, they have worries. I ask them, well, I was saying, is this Bible shipwreck is really hard. Really hard to explain to 4 years old, 5 years old, six year old kids. But then some of them really get it. They struggle. They have worries. They worry about their parents. They worry about their school. They worry about their friends. And it was even surprised when one, I have drawn a thermometer, and you have to color how high is your worry, and one put to the rim, up to number 10. Well, it says that knowing and acknowledging our worries and our struggle helps a lot. So I hope we identify our struggles. We identify our worries. If you are struggling today, my brother, my sister, be reminded that God is with you. He might not remove your struggle. No. God might not remove your struggle, but his presence is with you to help you and see the truth. So when we struggle, Psalm 46 verse 10 says, Be still, my son. Be still, my daughter, and know that I am God. The fourth one, when you do wrong, Jesus rescues. Jesus promised eternal life to the criminal on his right side when they were hanging on the cross. But we have to remember that the criminal believed in Jesus, that he had a paradise, and that he was indeed the Messiah and the King in the paradise where he was going. In short, we need to acknowledge and repent of our sins and accept Jesus as our Lord. And the Lord Jesus alone can save us from our sins. We have to acknowledge that. Now, the question, have you done something wrong in the sight of God? Maybe that was last year. Maybe that was last month. Maybe you did something wrong last week. Maybe you did something wrong yesterday. I don't know. But I know that you know it. You know what you did, and God knows it. Now, the challenge, surrender it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. Come to Jesus and surrender that sin and ask Him to rescue your soul. The last one, when we are powerless, Jesus rescues. This is the final topic. When we are powerless, Jesus rescues. The disciples met a crippled man who was crippled since birth, and that man was asking for alms. It's a beggar, is asking for alms. But then Peter and the disciples said, silver and gold have I not. Silver and gold have I not, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. So the beggar was begging for alms, but then Peter had nothing to give. But then Peter said, no, we can give you anything. Well, this beggar was powerless. He couldn't do anything about his situation. What could change his situation? It was Jesus. It was Jesus. When the disciples declared Jesus into this beggar, crippled man, this man came, walking and leaping and praising God. Walking and leaping and praising God in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. And the man walked. Now, is there something that we feel powerless over today? What is that something in us and with us that we feel powerless about? I know that I have my limitation. I know that I can do anything. I know that there are things that I cannot address. What do I do? What do we do? Our text tells us, speak the name of Jesus. Speak the name of Jesus over that something that you are powerless about, and trust Him to address your need. Indeed, Jesus rescues. This is the reason why He came to this world, to rescue us, to save us. May we be reminded to have that childlike faith. No, shipwreck and then we're rescued by Jesus. Oh, that's for kids only. Tell those to the kids and they will believe you. Now, this is not just for the kids. It's for all of us. It's for you and for me. Do you believe it? So, the challenge, let us have this childlike faith and believe that indeed Jesus rescues. Jesus rescues those who put their trust in Him. One of Ted's worries, pardon me for mentioning him again, Ted. One of Ted's worries about this Bible school is that, oh, will I be able to lead the vacation Bible school? He would say.
True.
Yeah. Later on, as the days progressed in the Vacation Bible School, I overheard him saying, "All the pieces of the Bible school have taken their perfect place." And I have seen God working in our Vacation Bible School. Amen?
Amen.
For me as a pastor, I have a lot of worries. And one of my worries when I was in the Philippines was that members would come to me and scold me. "Pastor, why haven't you done this? Why have you done? You said that this would happen," and then they would point a finger at me. But that's just, it's a worry, but not really a worry now. One of the worries that I have right now is thinking if ever the church that I am assigned to would close its doors and cease to exist. I have witnessed churches closing down. Darla, you have witnessed, right? In the annual conference. Perry, you have witnessed. Those who have attended the annual conference, Iowa annual conference, you have witnessed that every annual conference, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 churches in our annual conferences are closing. And these churches have existed even 1900s, 1850, 1860, as early as that. And they are closing down. In the Philippines, it is different. We don't close church. We open churches. We open extension churches. We open mission churches. Now, my question. How young is the youngest member of Grace United Methodist Church who is committed to God and has the heart to serve Him through this church? How young? 84? 76? 60? 54? 25? 19? I have been worried. I tell you, I have been worried. And I said, "You have to do something, Ruby, you have to do something." But then I had realized, it's not me. It is God. It's not about me. It is God. When Jesus is the one thing and the main thing that is lifted up and glorified in the lives of the people called the church, it will survive. Amen?
Amen.
The Vacation Bible School proved my worries to be wrong. The turnout of the crews that helped, the turnout of the children coming, we were expecting 10.
Yeah, maybe 10. We had a lot of competition. There were other churches in the area that were having Bible school at the same time.
The turnout proved me wrong. The turnout of the people who wanted to share the love of God to the young proved me wrong. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, I have worries. I know that you have to. Sometimes I feel shipwrecked. And I know sometimes you feel shipwrecked too. Let us be reminded that in all of these things, Jesus comes to rescue us in our situation. So, the question today, are we lonely? Are we worried? Are we struggling? Did we do something wrong? Do we feel powerless over something? Let us put God first in our life. Put God first. Let Jesus be that main thing, that one thing. And let us trust God, for He comes to rescue us. He comes to rescue this church. He comes to rescue you and me. For those who trust in Him, the Lord will save. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand and join in singing our closing hymn, "Bind Us Together, Lord."
Cords that cannot be broken.
Together we are being built into a holy dwelling place where God lives by the Spirit and God is lifted up. So go out with joy and confidence to love and serve the world, for we do not go alone. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.